Episode 1706, My Strength is My Story with Melissa D. Arabian, Tasting Grace.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've got the place. This is the show you can turn to just pick me up you need. This is Create Your Now, your best selfie. Here your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, and well.
Today is Thursday. My Strength is My Story, and with in a house, Melissa D. Arabian, she is the next.
Which is not what I believed at my core when I was younger. I mean, I think somehow I sort of thought, well, yeah, money doesn't buy you happiness, but secretly I kind of thought it might. and my mom's death showed me very deeply otherwise. So I really believe that.
What a beautiful tribute. Truly. Your mom has got to be smiling down right now. You know, just saying, that's my girl. That's my girl. Well, you have a lot of different layers, just like with food, right? And you know best, you're the expert. We know how to layer them on, spices and herbs and different sauces that we use. Most people would not know how many layers you really do have. Let's see, you worked for Disney, both in the United States and Paris. You worked in corporate America for finance. You have an MBA, and do you also have a JD? Or did I do that? Oh, no. Okay.
No,
but
no.
Your hope was to be a JD.
I started out as a JD MBA.
Okay.
I was going to law school and getting an MBA as sort of an extra. And then I ended up just getting the MBA and dropping the law degree.
Gotcha. I read that somewhere.
Yeah, that's not completely made up. I started out with the plan to be a JD MBA and then ended up with the MBA. And law school just wasn't. It wasn't the right fit for me.
Yeah, and that's great. But you also were interested in television. Can I just say The Dating Game and General Hospital? Go figure.
Right? I know, isn't that funny?
Where did this performance thing come in for you?
Well, I always was involved in theater and in performing. And so I loved that. I think it comes down to the connection and connecting into stories. I love story. I think that's why I love television and I love movies. I love story because it's universal. It speaks to our humanity. I love going to the ballet because there's, you know, even when there's not a story, there's still a story. There's still a sharing of the human condition that I find so beautiful and holy. I find it holy when somebody can make me feel what the human condition is like through their art, you know, and that art can be, you know, a great chef doing a beautiful plate. It can be in the ballet. It can be, I love musical theater because you add in story and then you have story and then you add in the layer of music, which it speaks to our souls in a way, in yet another way. So you're feeling the story in a yet a deeper, more powerful way. I love story. I love the human condition. I love humanity. I love the beauty of heart and triumph and the blood, sweat, and tears of going and giving it our all and doing our best. I love story.
And you have some beautiful stories in here. You all are going to want to pick up your own copy of Tasting Grace, Discovering the Power of Food to Connect Us to God, One Another, and Ourselves. Well, in your book, you have 16 chapters. We're not talking about the introduction. We're not talking about the acknowledgments, the conclusion, none of that. Just 16 core chapters. And you call them invitations. Some of them are like compassion, authenticity, nurturing, comfort, grace, stewardship, creation, patience, humility, connection, work, delight, acceptance, dependence, hospitality, and the sacred. Wow, that's a lot to cover. In this small little book, it's so jam-packed. But at the end of each of them, I've just got to flip to this. At the end of each of them, because there's an invitation, you also have the RSVP. With every invitation, we need to RSVP. And I'm thinking, we need to be, you know, teaching these young ones about RSVPing because they don't do a really good job. But I love how when you go through the invitation that you offer a way to respond. How could you move forward in this invitation? And so I have to ask you, what was the hardest invitation for you to write about?
Ooh, what was the hardest one to write about? In some ways, the hardest ones to write were actually the ones that I wrote the first. I wrote about them first because they were things I struggled with, and I needed to work them out a bit to understand why I needed to write this book, if that makes any sense. Because this is, Tasting Grace is the book that, and I'm looking this way because I have the book in my hands. Tasting Grace is the book that nobody asked me to write. Mm-hmm. Nobody, except me and God. And it was the book that, it was the project in my life where nobody was telling me, here's a deadline, here's, go do it. And it was just me showing up for it. And I knew that there was something that I wanted to write about, but it wasn't even about write about. It was something I needed to learn and reconcile about food culture versus what God wanted me to feel and think about food. And so I knew that food was important to me. So when I sort of thought about, like, what is this? I guess my first thought was, are we doing it wrong? Like, are we as society doing it wrong? And do we need to do it differently? And the answer to that is yeah, a little bit, you know, yes. But it's not a book of admonitions. And my experience was not one of, oh my gosh, I should really do this differently. I should really cook, you know, more homemade food for my family. It's not admonitions. What I was surprised by is that they really were invitations into letting go of the guilt, of the negativity, of a lot of the stuff that I felt yucky about with food. I realized I was creating, and society was creating, and God wasn't, and God was inviting me into such goodness. So when I first started writing about, like, well, what does God have to say about food in the Bible? And what has he said to me about food in the Bible? Because I'm the one who's writing this book. I have to be willing to show up for that and pour myself into it. And the first chapters I wrote were the chapter in the cafeteria. So writing the book about realizing I was poor as a child and how that happened in a cafeteria and how people were the hands and feet of Jesus to me. Like, even as I'm saying it, I start to cry. And I've been looking at this story now for 2.5 years. That was hard to write, but I had to write it because I knew there was something there. And in doing the writing, I come out the other end feeling invited and closer into God. And I realized that's how I got to it being invitations. And then the other chapter that was hard to write was about my mom's death and about and how food offered me comfort through people through that season of post-mom's death and reconciling her suicide, and how women in particular really rallied around me and how food was part of that healing process. So that was hard to write. That was hard to write. But it was also the first stuff that I wrote because it was hard. I also knew that the answers to why me and why this book were in those stories.
When people go through traumatic experiences, and you've had not an easy life. I mean, some people will look at you and say you've got a life of luxury, right? But they don't know where you came from growing up. In your book, you tell many stories. You tell even about being called to the principal's office. We're not going to say much about it because they're going to have to pick up their own copy and read it. But it's when you got kind of your first job in the food industry, just saying, at a very young age. But it was a way for you to actually be able to survive. It was somewhat of a survival skill. Also with your mom's death and her committing suicide, when people experience tragedies, there's this question mark, I think, for those who have never experienced maybe something as bad as, I mean, we can't compare our stories, but for those of the listeners who are sitting there going, how do you ever get over this? Does your tender heart ever heal? Does it?
Well, the good news is yes. You know, things do heal, right? Yeah. They and they get redeemed. The best that I could get is redeemed. But even, what was it? Even just the other day, I can't even remember what it was, that I was thinking, ah, oh, I wish my mom were here for this. You know, and she's been gone for 30 years. And it wasn't even a big thing. It was like a small thing. I can't remember, but I mean, it's what happens. The good news is the joy is big enough to house that sorrow. And the joy is big enough to house that sorrow and use it for my good. It's so does that mean that I wouldn't trade it all back to have my mom here? Of course not. No, I'd rather have my mom here. But it gets redeemed. And, you know, in the book, I talk about sort of a really fun, special way that it gets redeemed, which, by the way, we were just talking about yesterday at dinner or something. My daughter was like, wait, what? I don't know that story. And I thought, okay, mental note, you know, tell the kids that story. Like, I'm like, oh yeah, all these things. I'm like, wait, I'd forgotten how personal this all really was. You know, when you're writing it, you know, at 5 a.m. in a dark room and it's just you and a cup of coffee and God, you know, easy to be brave in a sense, right, with the computer. And then you're sort of writing, you're like, oh, wow, yeah, I guess this is all coming out now. so anyway, but my mom's death gets redeemed in a really beautiful way that, I guess the best I can hope for is a joy that's big enough to house it and to recognize the redemption and to take the gifts that come from it. And but, you know, the daily sorrow, it does get smaller. It does. But it never goes away.
Yeah, I would agree with you. It doesn't ever go away. But there's a different way, I think, that we learn to celebrate and we learn to see it. And when we look at, like you say, the inside job, joy is an inside job. We've got to really understand that. And I really hope that people will take to heart and read this book. I mean, you could take one invitation at a time and just like sit on that one for a week to 2 weeks at a time and make it like a 16-week Bible study. You can make it a 32-week Bible study. I mean, it would be amazing how women, even men, but I think women especially, because of our natural ways of nurture, how God made us, that we tend to hold on, and it's hard for us to let go and let up and say, God, you take it. You take it all. Give me the joy that only you can give.
And it's amazing how, you know, we have these 16 invitations. It's amazing how even, you know, I was eating on my flight this week, a salad on Delta, and like even just this salad comes, it's like, you know, not very impressive airplane food salad. And it comes and I just took a moment, and so many of my invitations were in that salad. You know, like I'm invited into the patients, I'm invited into the connection, I'm invited into community, even like the person next to me, even the flight attendant who's like, oh, do you want, you know, more cranberry juice or whatever. You know, the miracles are there if we just take a moment to be mindful and aware of them. It's, you know, even one bite of every meal has the ability to invite us into a bunch of these invitations and has the ability to draw us closer to God and to bring us, every meal is a chance for the miracles. And that's just, I mean, it's amazing. It really is amazing. It really is. My hope is that people will see their own stories and that these stories will help readers think about their own food stories and see God in their own food stories and their own food experiences. And my hope is that no meal will ever be the same again. No meal will ever be miracle-less for people as they go through. Never be without the joy of knowing that our God is generous and is giving us his best. You know, that's my hope and dream for the book. And it's a big dream, but I know God's big. So that's my hope.
He's very big, and I got that hope in reading your book. And I also really began with me personally, it resonated, because you talk a lot. I mean, you get personal. But let's be real. You hit it hard. You were one who struggled with addiction. We're not going to give everything away, but I think it was the Plum Tree Inn.
Yes.
And can I just say, you know, going to the LAPD lot to pick up your vehicle, we're only going to go that far. We'll just leave the rest for imagination. And then they can fill in the blanks after they get the book. But you've got that. And then you've got the thing with food. When you wrote in there, you know, I had four babies in diapers. At one point, you were nursing. I mean, I'm assuming you were nursing the twins also. You didn't lose weight. It just stayed on. And this connection with food and everything, I mean, it was like a roller coaster ride. You talked about, which we've already talked about, your growing up and your mother's death and how everything intertwined, and also meeting your amazing husband. Can we not forget him? Oh my gosh. All of this, God's hand was in all of it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How has, when you have written this book and you've put pen to paper, looking back, how has your perception of food now changed from when you were growing up and even as a celebrity chef?
You know, now this is a little bit what we were talking about before, how like my faith journey's had these sort of events that have kind of morphed my faith. And so same thing with food, right? How I've looked at food has changed. You know, when I was a kid, it was always they didn't have enough. So this lack, not having enough, gave me this sense of when you have food, you eat it. And, you know, that you, so it just was, and there might not be more later. So when you don't have enough of something, that shapes how you look at food. And then, you know, working in food and food media, that also morphs how you look at food. And then, you know, living in Paris, I talk about how, like, getting into the ingredients and how the ingredients really spoke to me, and how I saw God in the ingredients. That changed how I looked at food. I saw food more as a gift. So how I've looked at food has sort of changed and morphed over the years. Writing this book, being intentional about, okay, well, now I'm going to write it. Now I'm going to really put language to this. I came out of the other side of writing Tasting Grace with a whole new, like the last chapter of Tasting Grace should really be a chapter that I write after I've submitted the book. Do you know what I mean? Like, that should be, like, there should be 17 invitations. And what the 17th invitation would be, I don't even know what I would call that, but I guess into the miracle, because each meal now represents all 16 invitations, where it used to kind of be like, okay, I was really fragmented in the invitations, like that, you know, the invitation into compassion and sort of, oh, I got that from these people when I was this age, and then, you know, invitation into acceptance of my body as a masterpiece. Well, that's, you know, linked to this set of stories and whatever. So it was a little bit more fragmented because I had to stay organized because, you know, because that's what you have to do as a writer. But God's invitations aren't separated out in outline form. They are mixed and messy and holistic and coming at you. It's like, you know, Christmas tree ornament hooks, you know, at the bottom of the Christmas tree box. Like, you pick up one and they all come with it. You can't separate them out. That's the generosity of God. It's so everywhere and multidimensional that I almost can't sit down even on an airplane to eat a lackluster salad without taking a moment to drink in the miracle and the gratitude. Like, writing this book completely changed how deeply miraculous I find our food system to be, and that I get to play a part and write my own verse on this great play that God has written for us. is truly extraordinary. I'm blown away, and I'm grateful. And so the 17th chapter would be, I think, the miracle of in each bite. Each bite has all of these invitations. I could sit and pray about any one of these in every bite that I take. So that's been a huge gift.
Oh, it's a gorgeous gift. And when you think about it, you actually talk about in, and I can't remember which invitation chapter it was, of where if you have an issue with food or your relationship, it's to take a bite and then pray before the next bite and say a prayer before the next bite. I'm like, that is fabulous, because it slows us down, right? We're so into this mindset of fast, fast, busy, busy, here we go, what's next? And we're gobbling our food down in less than 10 minutes. That's ridiculous. I'm just saying, that's ridiculous. But that's how we eat nowadays. But I love how you say, slow down, really enjoy it. Invite yourself into the presence of God and what He has in store for you with each bite. Beautiful.
And us praying for me, this like food and our body image and women and mixed messages, and there's all this going on in society, and for me that's sort of a slippery slope zone. And so for me, my answer to the slippery slope is just relentless, constant prayer. So in that same chapter, I talk about how I pray before I work out, because while our bodies are meant to eat healthy food and eat God's gorgeous, wonderful, delicious food, and our bodies are meant to move, we're meant to move, that's the way we were built. But, diet and exercise for, worship of societal norms and values, and that we want to be in a bikini and be beautiful, whatever, looks an awful lot like eating healthy and moving our bodies in worship of God. And without regular prayer, I cannot be trusted to know the difference. I just can't. So for those slippery slope zones, I literally just pray before I work out, because I need to keep my motives pure. Pure, that sounds too hard to do. But I need to be in worship of my Creator, not His creation. And that's a zone for me that's tricky. For other people, maybe not. Maybe they aren't just imagining themselves on a bikini, whatever, with every, but that's my slippery slope. So constant prayer, just relentless prayer, just praying every, and if it's before every bite of food or if it's before every workout, whatever it is, the answer for me is prayer.
You share a story in your book, which of course everybody's going to want to pick up their own copy of, Tasting Grace, Discovering the Power of Food to Connect Us to God, One Another, and Ourselves. You mentioned the bridge, and I love how you talk about stepping on the bridge and what it means with faith and all. Can you share that part with us?
Yeah. It's not a metaphor that I've made up, but I've heard it said, so you may have heard it as well, but that you don't know the true strength of your faith until it's tested, much like you don't really believe that the bridge can hold the weight until you go and you step out on it. There's a beauty in that is that we can step out before we really know that everything is going to be okay. And the good news is that, God has us in everything, right? And we also then get the gift that when we do step out and the bridge stays, we do get that gift of faith as well. So, it's sort of kind of both ways, right? We can step out and trust that God will hold us. Now, does that mean that we can take any risk we want and we'll never be harmed? No, that's not what that means. Like, we're living in a world of physics and science, and God has created this world where there are certain consequences and whatever. But it does mean that if we get it wrong, that God can redeem that decision too. And so that we can live in faith that we're not in this alone, and we may I've certainly made tons of bad decisions and whatever. And even that, God can weave that into good for me. Right. So the bridge is just it's a beautiful metaphor for that, for our faith, stepping out on it. And knowing that when we do step out on it, that's when our faith gets stronger. Because we can sort of look back. I'll look at it in a different way. I look back at my life and I cannot find one instance in earnest where God really dropped me. I've certainly had lots of disappointments and bad things happen, right? But I've never been dropped. So if we can carry that faith going forward, the same God who hasn't dropped me in the past is not going to drop me in the future. Again, that doesn't mean that I will always get the job, I will get the whatever, or that when I step out, it's going to work out for me. Nope. But I just have to show up. I just have to show up and be obedient and just show up. I don't even have to be good. I just have to show up. So, you know, when it's writing the book, I just have to show up at the computer. And for me, that's a slippery slope zone as well. Like I think, oh, maybe I'm not good enough. Maybe I'm not whatever enough or wise enough or inspired enough today. Maybe I am smart enough, but I'm just not inspired enough today. Doesn't matter. I just show up. I show up and I will literally be in my bed at like 5:30 in the morning because I'm an early morning worker, writer. And I will just say, oh, I don't feel inspired. I'll say, you know, God, I'll meet you at the computer. Let me get coffee first. And I'll swing by and I'll get coffee and I'll be like, okay, here we are. I'm showing up. I don't really believe that we're going to actually do anything of value today, but I'm just showing up. I'm showing up. So much of life is just showing up. Just showing up. You know, and God does miraculous things when we show up.
Amen. Amen. And also, they're going to have to read the book, too, because you talk about your runs and a bridge and how you pause now when you get to it and you have a time of gratitude, mm-hmm. which I think is absolutely beautiful. It just, you know, stepping back, I know you're the author of the book, but for someone who hasn't met you until now and has been able to peek into your story, God has blessed you in a tremendous way. And I know, though, in the thick of it, it may not have felt that way. I mean, we got to be honest, right? When we're in the messes, it doesn't feel like blesses at all. I mean, it just feels like major storms and hurricanes coming on top of us. But to see it from afar, what beauty he has carved out. What a masterpiece in you, Melissa.
And he, you know, we don't see sometimes that it's our best. And I talk about in Tasting Grace how food is really a glimpse into the bigger story of the generosity of God and the gifts of God, which is, you know, not a coincidence that Jesus is the bread of life, right? So we are through food given a glimpse into so much of the mystery and wonder and vastness and expansiveness of God. So, you know, it's a little bit like when, you know, I make this amazing meal for my kids and like, you know, healthy and delicious and all these things. And they're like, I don't want that. I want licorice or whatever. And you're like, really? Like, how could you turn down this amazing gift that I'm giving you because you want something that tastes sweet and sugary right this minute? Like, don't you know that I have your best interests in mind? But isn't that the same thing with God? When we're in the midst of it, we're like, I don't want the green beans and salad. I want something that feels good right now. I want that and sugar. Like in life, right? We can learn so much, get a glimpse into so much of the bigger generosity of God through his generosity in food. And so I find that like in life to think, oh, like, am I just like kicking and screaming and saying, oh God, I don't want the green beans. I just want the licorice, you know? And he's like, Melissa, my child, this isn't a punishment. It's a gift. And I have the bigger picture in mind. I understand that a green bean doesn't taste as sweet as a piece of licorice, but trust me, I have you covered. And so food gives us a glimpse into that, right?
Such a beautiful glimpse to God's creation and what has he created within each of us. I think that's something, the identity, you mentioned that earlier. I think everybody struggles with that, and moms especially. Dads do too. Dads, but they have a different identity crisis, and that's for a whole nother episode.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, but you know, us moms, there is that identity as to who are we, where we belong, and God says you belong right here with me. I have to ask you this because, come on, you've been on the Food Network. You've had, I don't know how many television shows, 3, 4, 5? A lot.
Yeah.
a few of them. So when you are standing in your kitchen and you haven't planned for dinner, what is your go-to meal?
Well, I will say, and listen, it happens to me all the time, where I'm like, how did it sneak up on me? Like, one, I've been cooking for my family for, you know, 15 years. And P.S., I make my living in food. So if it sneaks up on me, where I'm like, oh, shoot, it's 6 o'clock again? What? Dinner time? So I just want to say I feel everybody's pain. My go-to is I really load up on the vegetables and then back into the other stuff. Because I pull out the crisper drawer and I'm like, whatever needs to be used up, because there's always something that needs to be used up. So I start there. Also, I'm a big believer in serving at least 2 vegetables with every meal, just because I think it just gives us a variety and whatever. So I start with the vegetables. The other thing that I will also often do is I will get some kind of grain going. I have a gluten-free daughter, so I will often have like brown rice going, or I'll get some quinoa if I'm in a rush. Those are kind of 2 go-tos. And I figure once I get vegetables going, I usually have like 1 roasted vegetable and 1 raw vegetable. So that could be like chopped up cucumbers into a little tangy salad, or it can be lettuce, it can be a handful of baby spinach, or it can be kale that I just, you know, put lemon and olive oil on and a little bit of garlic. So I will often have 1 hot vegetable that I roast. I get that onto the pan and get it roasting. And then I do a cold vegetable, and then I get a grain going. And then I sort of back into, okay, is there some sort of protein that I can add to it? And it doesn't have to be a meat protein. And if I haven't thought through dinner in advance, sometimes it's just like beans that I'll pull from the freezer and like season up or whatever. So I start at the vegetables, add in a grain, and then if I can, I'll add in, you know, a protein. My daughter, one of my 4 daughters doesn't eat meat at all. And so we do have some meatless meals where nobody eats meat, but we also have meals that are complete for her, but then meat is sort of on the side. So that's how I approach it. But I just want to say, happens to me, I get stuck in the like, wait, what? How did that happen? I haven't thought about dinner at all today. So it happens. It just happens. So
I'm normal.
My go-to. Yeah. Yes. And you know what? I will also say something else to make everyone feel better, because people feel bad, like, oh, but I always burn things, or I don't get them out at the right time, or whatever. When I'm multitasking, things can get burned too. That happens to me too. It happens because you're multitasking. And when I'm just doing food stuff, like I'm creating recipes, or I'm like creating videos or whatever, I'm purely just focused on the food. And then I don't burn things. Then I'm, you know, like I'm 100% into food. But when I'm cooking as a mom, not as a cook, stuff like that happens all the time, because I put it in and then I'm racing. I'm getting this and I'm getting the kids that, I'm getting whatever. And next thing you know, I'm like, oh, shoot. Those cookies have been in longer than I thought. I'm like, oh, they're kind of, oh, they don't look as good as I want them to. Like, it happens. And it's because I was momming while I was cooking. So I just want people to know that when I'm cooking as a cook, I'm pretty on my game. I'll be honest. I'm pretty on my game. Things don't get cooked. I mean, don't get burnt. But when I'm cooking as a mom, holy cow, it's a whole different game, and all bets are off, and all sorts of craziness ensues, and like the roast will get overcooked, and I'll be like, ugh, sorry. Like, so just, you know what? There's grace. There's grace for that. It doesn't have to be perfect. You know what? It doesn't have to be perfect. It really doesn't. We just have to show up.
I love that. You titled your book Tasting Grace. As we come to a close slowly, where did that title come from? Because it truly does wrap up your book beautifully.
It actually came from a friend of mine named Mindy. This wonderful, wonderful friend of mine. I actually write about it in my acknowledgments. And she had this gift for giving amazing gifts. She would write notes with all of her little gifts. And she once gave me a little bottle of perfume called Simple Grace. And in her note, she said, "Thank you for all the grace that you've shown me." I was her small group leader in a Bible study. And just this amazing, wonderful, strong woman. And when I was doing all this writing and thinking, oh, like, what are, you know, these invitations and, you know, all this was sort of coming together. I used to carry her, I still do, her perfume, because it was a small bottle, with me as my travel perfume. So I would, like, send her pictures and be like, oh, look, I'm thinking of you. Like, I have your grace with me. She gave it to me, I want to say, like, 3 or 4 years ago. So I just, like, carried around with me. And I just use it when I travel, just so it was my travel perfume. And so one time when I was sending her the picture, I'm like, oh, thinking of you, you know, sending her the picture, I realized, I'm like, oh, this is Simple Grace. Well, this is, I'm tasting grace. So it was inspired by Mindy. Mindy passed away just a couple of weeks ago. She was fighting cancer and had been fighting cancer and then was in remission, and, you know, and so to be part of that journey with her and to have her grace with me. And in fact, when I got the ARCs, the advanced reader copies of Tasting Grace, so those are the books that come out, like, they're like drafts, so they're not real books, but they're drafts. The book, when I got my copies, she was the first person that I wanted to give it to. And I went over to her house and I was like, this title is because of you. And it's, and when I wrote that, I did not know that, that she was on a path that she wouldn't be here for when the book actually came out. So I got my final, copies of the book, 2 days after I spoke at her funeral. And so to get the copy, and I read the acknowledgments to her in ARC, and I had written, this is until the real copy comes out. And so Mindy never got the real copy. She missed it by a matter of days. But I didn't know it at the time, that she would be in the title and right there. So I would get to look at a little bit of Mindy every bit. Every time I saw Tasting Grace or saw the title, like, that's what I think about. I think God weaved, God brought it together. He created it in such a way that I had no idea what her inspiring the title would mean, in terms of, for me, my little bit of Mindy in that legacy. So anyway, so the title is really special to me, and I acknowledge Mindy in it. And back when I wrote it, I didn't know that that I would be acknowledging it after she was gone. So so thank you for asking about the title.
Oh, you're welcome. Well, Melissa, I have so enjoyed our time together, and I know people are going to want to connect with you. Where can they find you?
I'm on Instagram and Facebook. I mean, I'm also on Twitter, but I really, Instagram and Facebook, Melissa D. Arabian for both of those. And then my website is melissadarabian.net. So those are sort of the three places where I interface with people. So, yeah. And then I send out an email every single Friday, which is actually an email. Like, if you reply to that email, it comes to my phone. Like, I'm on Fridays, like, I'm always like replying back to people like, oh, I just got your email. So I'm like, oh, we're actually, you know, now like on the phone together, like hanging out. So I send out an email and people can sign up for that, on my website or on my Facebook.
And don't you also have something on Facebook Live every Tuesday? It's Tuesday
yes.
night somewhere.
Yes, I do a cooking show every Tuesday on Facebook, and people can comment there. And it's really just inspiring people to make a simple meal or a simple dish for their family that's affordable and doable. So I do it a lot, like, in my own kitchen, You know, it's not anything fancy. I'm not wearing lashes or anything. I'm like wearing like, you know, my workout outfit or whatever. But that's how we cook on the weeknights. So I wanted to do something that wasn't about the false lashes and the makeup and the TV. I wanted to share recipes that that I make for my family. So I've been doing that for about 3 years. So that's every Tuesday. And also all the videos are on my Facebook page. So, you know, you can go and watch videos forever because it's been 3 years of doing that every Tuesday.
You can binge watch, and I've done a few of them myself already. And I'm telling you, you get hooked. I'm like, okay, wait, I gotta write this one down, and then I write another one down. It's fabulous. Well, before I let you go, the series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
My story has gifted me being closer to God, for sure. The way, you know, my story, anybody's story, but my story, you know, with loss, yucky, good decisions, bad decisions, things working out, some things not working out, all of that has been my story, and all of that has just sucked me right on up into being close with God. So for that, if it took that story to get me closer to God, then I love my story.
And I love your story. And I cannot wait for people to pick up their own copy. Melissa, thank you so much. I cannot wait to have you back. There's so many more things we could talk about. You'll just have to come back again.
Yes. Thanks so much. Bye.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.